From a sampling theory. In the first unit, we discussed about what do you mean by sample and what do you mean by sampling. See, the main purpose of sample, selection of sample, is to, the main purpose is to generalize. So it is very difficult to conduct research for whole population. If the population is a large number, more than 1 lakh, so it is very difficult to collect data, or it is very difficult to distribute questionnaires for all 1 lakh. So instead of collecting information from all those 1 lakh people, here researcher select a small part of whole population. So that small part is called as sample. The sample is nothing but a part of whole population selected for the purpose of collecting information. See, the advantage in the selection of sample is it is very easy and it is very less, or it is less costly when compared to collecting data from whole population. Instead of collecting 1 lakh people, if you collect from 100 people, so it can easily collect the data from 100 people, and the cost involved in the collection of data is also very less. So that is the one objective of sampling. Sample means a part of population is called sample. Sampling is the procedure or the process of selecting sample from whole population. Sampling is nothing but it is the technique. And we also discussed in sampling, we have two types of sampling. That is, one is a probability sampling, other one is non-probability sampling. Probability sampling and non-probability sampling, or random sampling or non-random sampling, same. Random and probability same, and non-random and non-probability are the same. See, what do you mean by probability sampling? In the last class also I told what do you mean by a probability sampling. Probability sampling means every unit in the population are get equal chance to be in the sample unit. You understand? Every unit in the population, for example, if there are 1 lakh students are there in one research, consider 1 lakh students are there. So out of 1 lakh student, if my sample size is 100, then what is the probability, what is the chances of getting chances of involved in the sample unit? Sample unit is 100 and population is 1 lakh. So for 1 lakh population, what is the chance, what is the probability? So very simple, we have to 100 divided by 1 lakh, so that is the probability. So see, that percentage, it may be 0.001, that is the probability. So every unit, every person or every individual in the population get equal chance in probability sampling. Out of 1 lakh, anybody can become a sample. So there is no preset of criteria for selection of sample unit. It is selected on random basis. Anybody can become a sample. So therefore, every unit in the population get equal chance in probability sampling. And there are different types of probability sampling. We discussed. And what do you mean by non-probability sampling? See, non-probability sampling means there is no equal chance for every unit in the population. For example, take your class. For example, in your class, there are 15 students are there. Out of 15 students, it may be eight male students and remaining 7 female students. Consider there are 8 male students and remaining 7 female students are there. So if I select randomly without considering their gender, if I select random. I need, for example, I need 7 students for my research out of 15. 15 is the population. Population size here 50. For my research, I need only 7 students. So if I select 7 students randomly without considering any criteria, then it is called as probability sampling. Therefore, because here every student, each 15 student get equal chance. So there is no preset of criteria. Anybody can become a sample in it. So if I follow that steps, then it is called as a probability sampling. For example, I need 7 students, but I consider I need only a female student. Out of 15 students, I need only female student. Then what is the chance for female student and what is the chance for male student? See, the probability of involving a female student is 100%. It becomes 100%. But what is the probability for male student? Zero. Because I focus only female students. So there is no chance for male student to be involved in the sample. So that is called non-probability sampling. So in the first example, I need 7 students out of 15 students. So I am not following any criteria. I am randomly selecting the 7 students. So that is called probability sampling. But in the second later example, in the second example, I need, of course, I need 7 students out of 15, but I am here following one criteria, that is I need only female students for my research. Then the chance for male student will become zero. So that is called non-probability sampling. In non-probability sampling also, there are different types of techniques are there for selection of non-probability sampling. So that is the sampling technique. Then after that, we come to come across the point called sampling theory. First thing is sample. What do you mean by sample? Then what do you mean by sampling? Then what are the sampling techniques? That is both probability sampling techniques and non-probability sampling technique. And after that, you should know what do you mean by sampling theory. See, once you select your sample, so sample means you are taking some part of whole population. You collect the information from your entire population, and the ultimate purpose of sampling is you have to generalize your information which you collected from your sample. You collected it from sample. For example, you collected it, you maybe collected it from 100 students. But while writing your analysis, you cannot write like out of 100 students, 70 students are agreed for some criteria. Consider I'm doing research on information literacy among college students. Information literacy among college students in Mangalore University. So the students in Mangalore University, there are 3,000 students are there. But for my research, I need 100. So out of 100, one finding, for example, one finding, it says that out of 100, 70% of students regularly go to the library. Out of 100, 70 students regularly go to the library for reading purpose. So how should I write this findings in my analysis? We cannot write like out of 100, 70 students are regularly go for library for their reading purposes. No, because here the entire population is 3,000 and we are taking samples. So once you select samples, the main purpose is for generalization. even though we collected from 100 students or 100 responding, but we have to write for entire population. How we should write? We should write like 70% of the Mangalore University student. 70% or majority. 70% of the Mangalore University students regularly go to the library for reading purpose. So that is the way of writing analysis. So that is we called as a generalization. Instead of writing our analysis for only sample, we cannot write our analysis for sample. We have to write analysis for whole population. So that is generalization. So while writing or while doing a generalization or before doing generalization, the very important point is we have to see whether there is a relationship, whether there is a significant relationship between the population and sample. Whether there is a significant relationship between the population and you samples, the samples you taken. So why it is like that? Why we should check whether there is a relationship? They mean, why, what is the requirement or what is the purpose of doing or to find out the relationship between the population and samples? We have to check whether the drawn samples or selected samples properly represent the whole population. Whether the drawn or the selected samples correctly represent whole population. If it is not, that means if there is no relationship between the population, entire population, opinion of entire population and opinion of samples, then you cannot generalize the information collected from the sample. Take same example. I collect my population is 3,000 students of Mangalore University, and I need 100 students for my research. 100 is the sample size. See, what if I distribute my questionnaire to the library science student? Okay, population, entire population is 3,000. I need 100 student for my research. If I distribute my entire questionnaire, or if I collect information from library science students, then what happens? Does their opinion represent whole population? No. Why? Because there is a compulsory rule for library science student. They have to go for library every day. They give like every 100% student, they have to go library. So therefore their opinion does not represent whole population. So therefore, while selecting samples, we have to select it randomly. That's why we call it as we have to go for random selection. We cannot go for convenient method or any other method which gives us a biased information or one-sided information. So therefore, first you have to check whether there is a relationship between the population and samples. There are some techniques are there which testify whether there is a relationship between sample and population. Otherwise, we get one-sided information, or there may be information which we cannot generalize to the whole population. I can give other information. See, other information is I want to see the awareness level among teaching faculty in stock market. I want to see what is the level of awareness among teaching faculty about stock market. See, while distributing or while collecting this information, I have to go for randomly. If I collect this information from those teachers who are from commerce and management background, because they know little bit about stock market. if I collect data only from the commerce and management student, so it gives a biased information or biased opinion. Or if I collect only from science faculties, they may not know about stock market. So there is a chance. So therefore, while selecting sample, we have to be very careful. And after that, once you collected your samples and after collecting the data, you have to check. You have to check the opinions given by the samples, and you have to cross check with the population. Therefore, before conducting the main study, we do a pilot study. I already discussed this concept. What do you mean by pilot study? Pilot study is a small part of research. Before going into or before jumping into main study, you are taking a very small part of samples and you distribute that questionnaire and you are checking the reliability and internal validity of the questionnaire. We are doing pilot study. Pilot study is nothing but before going to the main study, doing a small study. For example, your sample size is 100, but you are taking five students and distribute to the questionnaire to the five students. You are asking whether that questionnaire is readable to the students and whether it is understandable or whether it is convey the main objective of the research. So we have to see before going for main study, we have to see the understandability, whether the English or the sentence used in the questionnaires are easily understandable to the respondent. So therefore, we go for pilot study. So we do pilot study. From pilot study, we collect information. And after that, we have to do sampling theory. Sampling theory is nothing but it is a study of relationship of existing between a population and samples drawn from the population. And very important here, sampling theory is applicable only to random samples. If you select samples randomly, then only you can apply sampling theory test. Otherwise, you cannot. See, for non-probability or non-random sampling techniques, there is no need to test sampling theory to test the relationship between the population and samples. Most of the times, it does not represent whole population. And next one, in for this purpose, population or inverse may be defined as aggregate of items. So, what do you mean by the population? The definition of population is nothing but population is an inverse may be defined as aggregate of items possessing common traits or traits. So, the entire population means with those units which represent common traits. Common traits means common character. When we consider a population, for example, my study is online consumer. The behavior of online consumer during Dasara festival. If this is my study, I want to know what is the behavior of online consumer during Dasara festival. So at that time, who is my respondent? Who are my respondent? How should I identify who are my respondent? Very simple. Those respondents who have a common traits or common characteristics are considered as my respondent. So what are the common traits for online consumers? The online consumer, the common traits is those people regularly purchase their products in online websites are considered as an online consumer. So whoever purchased online are considered as an online consumer. So that is the common trait. Common trait here, the purchasing in online website is a common trait. So whoever have those character or those trait are considered as a population. Likewise, if you go for other research, for example, awareness of stock market, here what is the common trait? Common trait, whoever invested in stock market are considered as a common trait, or investment in stock market is a common trait. So I can go for whoever invested in the stock market are considered as a population. Or students, what is the common trait? Who were studying some course in a recognized university are considered as a student. So that is the common trait. So here, who possess a number of items who possess common trait are considered as a population. And see, while in sampling theory or while choosing a statistical tool also, we have to choose whether we have to go for parametric test and whether we have to go for non-parametric test. In third unit we have the parametric test, and in fourth unit we have non-parametric test. Then what do you mean by parametric test and non-parametric test? The parametric test means when you know the size of population, when you know the size of the population, then you have to, because we know the parameter, there are some parameter are there, so we know the parameter of the population. So if you know the size of the population, or if you know the size of the population is finite, then we have to use a parametric test. If you don't know the size of the population, then, or if the size of the population is infinite, then we have to go for non-parametric test. What is the finite and infinite in all of that? Finite means, for example, I know the size of the population. My study is information literacy among students in Mangalore University. I know the exact size of the students in Mangalore University. So I can go for administration department. I can say the admission, how many students are admitted for the different courses. So I can collect exact numbers. So there is a record. There is a record for admission of the students. So I can collect exact number of these students, or exact number of the entire population. The entire population is 3,000. I know. So that is called finite. So when you know the size of the population, then we have to go for parametric test. And other condition also there, but the main condition is the size of the population. And when you don't know the size of the population or infinite, then you have to go for non-parametric test. See, example, consider online consumer. If there is no record for how many people are purchasing online, then it is called infinite. Or consider a population. There are some for online consumers, there may be a record. See that here one example are there, tossing of coins or throwing a dice. So there is no exact number. How many times we can throw coins, or how many times we can toss the coins. So there is no a definite number. Any number, any time we can toss it. At that time, when you don't know the exact number of the population, then you have to use non-parametric test. Or we can take other example also, like how many students have smartphones. If I want to know the advantage and disadvantages of smartphone on students, then first thing I have to know the number of students are using smartphones. So this type of information are not recorded, are not classified. So at that time we have to go for infinite method by taking random number as a samples, or we have to assume population in some numbers. So that is called infinite population. We don't know the exact number of population. At that time, we have to go for non-parametric test. And what is the main objective of sampling theory? Why we should go for sampling? Same. Why we should go for sampling, or why we should check whether there is a relationship between sample and population? The first objective, as I said, we have to generalize our information which we collected from the sample to the entire population. So while we are going for generalization, the first important thing we have to see whether the selected sample is properly represent whole population. In simple words, the opinion given by the sample are truly represent the opinion of whole population. Sample says, for example, sample says 30% or 70% of the students are regularly attend, regularly go to the library for reading purposes. But while going for whole population, only 10% of the students are at regularly attend library for reading purposes. See the difference. So there is a huge difference. We call it as a standard deviation. So we have to check the standard deviation between the population and samples. If the standard deviation is very large, then it does not represent entire population. It does not correctly represent whole population. So therefore, the first thing while going for generalization, we need to check the relationship between the population and samples. Only if there is a statistically significant relationship between the sample and population, then only we can generalize. Otherwise, we cannot generalize. Even though, see, when you are generalizing to the area-wise also. For example, I am conducting study in Dakshina Kannada district, but I want to generalize it for entire Karnataka. You have to see whether the people of the Dakshina Kannada district or the behavior of the Dakshina Kannada district are equal to the behavior of other part of the Karnataka. Why, especially you are doing research on cultural based study, a cultural related study or a behavior related study. You have to be very careful. If it is financial matter or if it is other factor, there is no much what difference between the information given by the Dakshina Kannada district of the Karnataka. But if it is the research is related to the behavior and cultural related, then there is a definitely difference between Dakshina Kannada and other district of the Karnataka, because the behavior or cultural pattern of Dakshina Kannada district is entirely different from the North Karnataka. So we have to see. So we have to check whether there is the relationship between the, if there is a relationship between sample and population, then you can go for generalization. So that is the main purpose of sampling theory. And then see the second objective or second purpose of sampling theory is for statistical estimation, which is similar to the generalization point also. The statistical estimation, if you are going for estimation by using regression, we use regression for estimation purpose. So before going for estimation, you have to check the relationship between the sample and population. See, you are estimating entire population, the character of entire population based on samples. You are not collecting information from entire population for estimation purpose. You collect information from samples and you use the regression, then you estimate, then you generalize for whole population. Consider I am going to estimate what may be the sales of a particular company in the next year. So company established 50 years before. So it has a history of 50 years. So I can't collect or I can't use regression for 50 years statistics, 50 years data or 50 years report. What I do, instead of choosing a 50 annual report, I select last 10 years annual report. See, company has 50 years history. That is entire population. Here in this example, entire population is 50 years annual report. So I choose only a last 10 years annual report for prediction, for a prediction of sales. So I take last 10 years sales and I can predict by using regression, I can predict what may be the sales in the next year. So while writing analysis, it says like it collect information from entire population and generalize. But actually we collect it from samples and we generalize to the whole population. So while go for statistical estimation also, see if what happens if that last 10 years annual report, if it is does not represent properly, if does not represent properly of entire last 50 years, then your estimation may become wrong. For example, in the last year, or consider I take only last year's annual report. Think that what happened in the last year? Last year there is a pandemic happened. So due to pandemic, every company lost their revenue growth, or there is no sales in the last year. If you consider the numbers of the last years, so it does not represent properly, because in the last year it is called, in finance also we call it as abnormal year. So you may discuss in the while calculation of goodwill or while calculation of intrinsic value of shares, we have to ignore the abnormal year. In the calculation of goodwill, while considering average profit, we have to see that every year should be normal. There should not be an abnormal year. Abnormal year means year which may happen due to natural calamities or like pandemic or anything. It should be normal for prediction. Every time any prediction, the data collected from normal years. So if you collected data from abnormal year and you generalize for normal year, so it does not represent true record, or the estimation may not be accurate. So therefore you have to be careful while collecting sample also. It should be a normal year and it should be a represent whole population. The first purpose for generalization, and second purpose of sampling theory is statistical estimation. While going for estimation by using sample, you have to see the sample properly represent whole population. In estimation, it may be a point estimation or interval estimation. We'll discuss what you mean by a point estimation and interval estimation. And a third objective of sampling theory is to enable us to decide whether to accept or reject hypothesis. See, hypothesis means is a preset of assumption we make to satisfy or to meet the objectives of our research. Hypothesis is nothing but is a preset of assumption. Preset of assumption is made for to meet the objective of research. Consider my research is the objective of my research is to know the investment pattern of college teacher. So that is the main objective of my research. Consider That is the main objective, to know the investment pattern of the college teacher. Investment pattern means where they invest, whether they investing in equity shares or whether they investing in banks or gold or real estate. So that is the pattern. So I want to know what is the investment pattern of college teacher. See here, what hypothesis I can develop? The hypothesis I can develop based on the previous study. Somebody did the same research, same means in other area, research, and he found that there is a relationship between, or there is a difference between, significant difference between investment of government college teacher and investment of private college teacher. There is a significant difference in the investment pattern of college teacher and government college teacher and private college teacher. You know that the it may be based on the salary of government college teacher is high compared to private college teacher, so it directly affect their investment pattern. So he finds that in his research, he finds that there is a significant difference between investment pattern of college government college teacher and private college teacher. So in my research, what I do, I verify, I cross check whether that findings is applicable or whether that findings is correct in my research. So in his research, he found that there is a difference. I want to know, I want to cross check whether that findings is correct or not. So that is called hypothesis. Also, while writing hypothesis, we write like assumption. We are not writing exact statement. We are not confirming it. We confirming it after testing it. So while writing hypothesis, hypothesis is assumption. We just write assumption. We are not confirming it. We are just writing assumption. For example, take same example. How I can write that statement in the form of hypothesis? See, in hypothesis, there are two types. One is null hypothesis. Other one is alternative hypothesis. Null hypothesis says there is no significant. It nullify. Nullify means it reject. It reject the relationship between two or more variables. So null means nullify. Null means reject. And alternative, the other hypothesis. So there are two type of hypothesis. One is null hypothesis. The other one is alternative hypothesis. So how I can write that statement in the form of null hypothesis? See, I can write like this. So there is no significant difference between there is no significant difference in the investment pattern among government college teacher and private college teacher. So that says null hypothesis, because I used the word called no. There is no significant. So while writing null hypothesis, we used the term called there is no significant. So how I can write alternative hypothesis? Alternative hypothesis is very simple. Alternative is like there is a significant relationship between in the investment pattern of government college teacher and private college teacher. So null hypothesis says there is no significant relationship, but alternative hypothesis says there is a significant relationship. I have to write both the statement, because I don't know whether there is a relationship or not, or there is no relationship. I have to say, but while writing hypothesis, I have to write both the hypothesis, both alternative and null hypothesis. And after that, I have to use some statistical tools, and I have to test. So for testing, after testing, I can decide whether I have to accept null hypothesis or reject null hypothesis, whether I have to accept alternative hypothesis or reject alternative hypothesis. So while or in the process of selecting or accepting and rejecting hypothesis, we have to do sampling theory. So sampling theory helps in determining whether observed differences are actually due to chance, or whether they are really significant, or sampling theory help in generalization about. That means, see, there may be a difference. There may be a difference between the investment pattern of a college teacher, a government college teacher, and private college teacher. That is not important. What is important? Important point is whether that difference is significant or not. See, in hypothesis testing, we are not just finding out the difference between the investment pattern. See, the difference we can see just by looking at the values. We can say that whether there is a difference in the investment pattern of government college teacher and private college teacher. Just by looking at the tables, we can say whether there is a difference or not. Why we should use statistical tools, and we have to develop hypothesis, and we have to go for some procedure. The important point is whether that difference is significant or not. So therefore, the main purpose of hypothesis and sampling theory, we want to know the difference, whether the difference between these two values are significant or not. So that is, with the help of sampling theory, we can, because while doing statistical tools, we get a probability value. By using probability value or p-value, we can say whether there is the difference is significant or not. The next concept is parameter and statistic. Parameter means is nothing but population, and statistic means sample. So what do you mean by parameter? Parameters are number that summarize data for an entire population. Statistics are number summarize data from sample. So if you collect data from entire population, so then it is called parameter. Parameter is the other word for population, because in statistic we do not use the word called population, we use parameter, and for sample we use the term called statistic. So that is only the word difference. Population, parameter, sample is the statistic. See here, one example is given. A researcher wants to estimate the average height of women aged 20 years or older from a simple random samples of 45 women. The researcher obtained sample mean height of 63.9 inches. So here researcher wants to estimate the average height of. He wants to find out what is the average height of the woman who aged 20 years or older. So he go for simple random sample. Simple, you know what do you mean by simple random? Simple random means first we collect the details of the population or samples. Like their phone number or their name, address always, and we record it. So first thing we have to, either we can go for lottery method, we have to write their name in chit and put it in the box or somewhere and pick it up. So while picking, if whatever name come in chit, I'll consider it as a sample. So that is a simple random technique, chit method or other. Random table. So by using random table, we can select the sample. So that is the two. One is the parameter and the other one is the statistics. In the next class, we'll discuss about a sampling distribution, and we'll discuss what do you mean by standard error and point estimation and interval estimation.